We're glad to be here from Fansong Foundation Nigeria. My name is John Dada, and this is Yakubu Isike. Thank you very much, Yakubu. It's critical for Yakubu to be here with me, telling the story later. Our mission, very ambitious, is to eliminate poverty. We have no problem with reducing poverty. We get rid of it. Initially, we thought it was a tall order, but as events unfolded, we realized that that really is what we must stick to in terms of our mission. And this is what has led us into several areas of services. We operate what we call an integrated model of service. And I should confess that there wasn't a grand master plan at the beginning. The services we provided unfolded as time went on. We thought initially that all we needed to do for eliminating poverty was to provide microfinance to our communities. So we would give loan to people, but very shortly after that, we realized that poverty wasn't just about money in the pocket. There was health issues, there were educational issues, there were housing issues, there were legal issues to tackle. So we began to move into these various areas. One of our choice areas of work is women smallholder farmers. In the communities where we live and work, the women call the shots. They feed the family. You really want good meal and reliable household food security, take care of the woman. And that was our winning strategy. That's why even our microfinance program focuses mostly on the women. And then we realized that as a result of the desert encroachment in the northern part of Nigeria, there was a lot of pressure on grazing land. There was competition for grass, for cattle, and competition for water. So we started a community grazing reserve. What we did was get a pilot, planted grass. Before then, of course, we had consulted with the communities, and the herdsman said, if you give us grass, John, we will pay for it, and we will pay for the water. So we have a grazing reserve now that has an overhead solar-operated water tank for animals. And then, this is for supporting older persons. When you live in a rural community, you know that the people who hold that community together are the elders. But in our particular situation, the elders are in a very vulnerable situation because we are in one of the hotspots for HIV and AIDS in Nigeria. And you have a situation where the parents have died, the grandchildren have been sent home from the urban centers, they are living with the grandparents. So the grandparents are getting weaker, the grandchildren are getting stronger, that's mismatch. So we had to start a program dedicated for the older persons, while we have a separate program for the children. And then of course, when you're dealing with children, you must look at education. And that was where our school-based management committee system came in. And then, after that, we went into provision of rural ICT services. Now, I must tell you that the genesis of this rural ICT services was the microfinance program, which we started. And how did that go? When we started the microfinance program, it was entirely paper-based. And every client had a paper file. And then it became cumbersome. At that time, there was 286 machines. Some of you may know about them. So I bought a 286 machine and took home and decided to put all the client's data in this machine. And the women clients came and said, John, what's this? It looks like a television. I said, no, it's not a television. It's a computer. It tells me how much you owe me. John, can you show me? I said, yes, this is your name. This is how much you owe me. And then, you know, women said, okay, John, can we learn to use this? So we started a class for women because we wanted to know how the computer operates. And typically, again, of women, I'm not being denigrated. They said, hey, John, this is good, but can you teach our children? And that's how the computer training school started. We began this computer training school. But you can see all along what we were doing was reacting to what the people wanted. And 9 years ago, I came across a young man name was Jacobo. Jacobo had never seen a computer when he joined us 9 years ago. Today, I need to rely on Jacobo for anything I need on the computers. He now gets the computer training section. And for us, the lesson here, is that for our sustainability, we have to look local. One of the problems I've had is this rapid staff turnover. When I take people like Yaku from ground zero to where he is, some big person in the big city will offer him 10 times what I can afford to pay him, and off he goes. I feel a bit disappointed and discouraged, but I'm happy for Yaku to move on. Because I have several of them now in several Nigerian cities, and they are my ambassadors. If there's anything going, they call me, Baba, have you heard about this? There's an opportunity going that Fanson can plug into. So in that way, we are building young people and starting from ground zero all the time, but it pays off in the end. Like this computer training center, it's the only rural-based computer training center in our area. Now what happens is when children are going to university, they have to take the pre-university examination. Now, several of them have to be posted to the nearest computer-based test center in the urban center. The hassle for these children is incredible. Like the problem of transport, problem of accommodation, all of that adds to their stress. So when a child doesn't even pass the examination, nobody thinks of what that child has gone through before they go to the exam hall. So I said, look, we'll set up our own computer-based test center, and we got approval for it, and now we're able to host 250 students at a time. Before weekend, we just run an examination where we have over 2,000 students coming to write examination there. Now these are kids who have had to travel to Abuja, to Jos, to Kaduna, with all the attendance problems involved. So what we do is react to the needs of the community. What we're doing is dictated by what the community needs. And it comes at a price. When I'm looking after my mothers, the grandparents, oh, by the way, I have 126 mothers. They are my mothers. That should qualify for the Guinness Book of Records. And that is a social service. Because each grandmother is entitled to a stipend every month, and they're entitled to free medical care in our clinic. That has to be paid for by someone. And it is this computer-based test center that is helping to defray the cost of this other services. Same thing with the microfinance. The profit from the microfinance is plowed back into these various services which we provide. People have spoken about the various infrastructural challenges, which is the same as you have everywhere. Line of sight issues, the cost of VSAT, the unreliable power. Of course, we have been able to install some solar power, and of course, the issue of technical expertise. We do our best to train people, but oftentimes we're always lagging behind. So we have a program called Gaya. Gaya in our language means gift of labor. And that's where people can come and volunteer. You can volunteer for a couple of hours, you can volunteer for an hour, for a day, a week, whatever you can spare within your leave time as an expert. There's room for you in Fanson Foundation to do that. And the Gaia department has turned out to be one of the business departments in our organization because of it has to coordinate the various volunteers that come in. The least number of volunteers at any given time in Fanson is 5. But we've had to handle volunteers as many as 85 when there's a need for it. There is always that pool of people within the community whom you can rely on. And just before I talk about this, I don't want to give the impression that it's all rosy. You're doing a lot at the grassroots level. And the lesson I have learned is we have neglected the political level where the elites operate. We don't talk to them. And at the end of the day, they just pull the strings. And everything we've done goes up in flames like this. These are houses that were destroyed through because of ethnic and religious conflicts. Well, that is the story given at the top. But we all know that it's all political gimmick. Some political guy somewhere is wanting to make some point, and then he uses religion and ethnicity as his flash point. And unfortunately, the people I deal with, religion and their ethnic group are very important to them. If you touch that, you've ignited fire. So the lesson I have learned is we cannot ignore that upper level. If you're working at the grassroots, you must know what's happening at the rooftop. If you don't, your work goes up in flame because those guys can't be bothered about what's going on at the bottom. Because when election time comes, they'll come to the village and distribute soap and bags of rice and sugar and buy the votes and go away. And then you are left with the consequences of your people not knowing their rights, not knowing that those people who have been voted in are actually their servants, who should be serving them. So that has been a very expensive lesson for us. But out of every harsh lesson comes an opportunity. And this is where, for me, the issue of the community networks comes in. It's not an issue of food or connectivity. It's an issue of food and connectivity. It's an issue of, because one of the things that the elites use is a lot of misinformation. And if I have my community networks linked to a community radio where the people can say for themselves what the true situation is, where they can talk to each other across these affordable networks, my work will be done. The misinformation that comes from the top will have been countered by the people themselves. And that is the lesson I'm taking away from the meeting here. There were a couple of points that Jane mentioned. And I want to, these are the things I want to take home. I need to know where the real power is. In my country, where we have several competing agencies that are responsible for communication, I've got to know exactly who to talk to so that I don't waste the little resources I have chasing the wind. The other thing is, there are several treaties that Nigeria has signed up to. I don't know half of them. But I know that through ISOC, I'll be able to find out what Nigeria has signed up to. Because once this has been signed up to, and people go home, just kept on the shelf. Nobody questions it, nobody asks for it. It's not that the government is against implementing those things, but there's no push. There's nobody demanding that, hey, can we have this thing which you said we will have? And then there's the issue of the TV white space and the GSM white spaces, which remains largely unused. I don't even know how much of it remains unused. Anecdotes say that in several African countries, in the rural communities, there are loads of the spectrum that is empty, unused. But once I can get that data, then I have the guts to move on to the minister. I say, excuse me, sir, there are these facilities that are remaining unused. And although I say I have not been talking to the rooftop, I know quite a few because of the number of moons I have seen. I have some of my colleagues who are at the rooftop now, who, if I present these facts to them, it will make a difference. And when I present facts like Yakubu, I'm telling them where Yakubu is coming from, and that there are millions of Yakubu who are out there willing to learn. He's like a sponge. He just absorbs information all the time, and he's quite happy to share. And that's typical of the youth where I come from. So the thing is for me to get the information, get informed, and then I can move on and work more with people like Yakubu. This is my sustainability factor. Because at the end of the day, whatever the community networks do, it's about the people. You must have people who can run with what you have. Carlos was telling me that Jay and you are going to take the Zeleny to the next step. This is my Jay and you here. Thank you very much. chief says, I should say, Nagode. Nagode means thank you very much.